Hello, I'm Maralee Sautter.
Morning.
Welcome to How to Train Your Dragon, Practical Lessons in Training and Learning. So here's the agenda. I don't really need to go through with it too much, but I guess I will. In the intro, we're going to learn about learners becoming trainers, and then we'll go through informal train and the definition of informal and formal training, learning styles model, a synopsis, characters and trainees in How to Train Your Dragon, and from trainer to train, from trainee to trainer, problem solving and skills of the exceptional trainer, and conclusion. And questions, comments, and sharing if there's time. Okay, so we'll just kind of move on here. So this is we've been trained and taught from the moment of birth, and so we watch and we learn from our family, our community, and our surroundings. And as we grow, we go to school and we continue to learn, and our teachers teach us, then we pass our knowledge on to peers sometimes. For example, a teacher trainer can be an older sibling who teaches a younger sibling how to hold a spoon or get into mischief, because that's kind of what training is all about, is you teach somebody to do something, right? Then there, throughout our lives, we have all of these situations where they're very, just very loose training. So everyday training is what I call it. And this session is about trainers and learners and their important relationship in the act of training. How to Train Your Dragon provides some really simple lessons from the standpoint of the trainer and the learner. So I hope you enjoy this session today, and I'll start with kind of the definition of in my brain here. So this is my definition of informal trainers and formal trainers. So I'm thinking that an informal trainer would be in everyday setting would be at a sports in a you know sports place, sports field, a kitchen table, and it has and this training it takes less systematic approaches to it as compared to a formal trainer who trains at the corporate office or businesses or a classroom setting. And you can see all of those things on the formal side that are very familiar to us as an instructional designer. And looking at how to train your dragon, most of what happens is on the field training, and then there's coaching and mentoring. And because it takes place in Viking times, there is no real, there's they don't go to the recordings. They do have books, but they don't have all of these things that we have today, where we can train through these other the other these other tools. So I'm gonna do this one model for you because it's been very interesting for me to present this and compare it. I used AI to develop some learning styles for the characters that I'll show you later. But this is a I'm going to make some comparisons to learners and trainers, but I wanted to use this VARC, which is visual, oral, and kinesthetic, and read and write. And so you can kind of see there what that type of a visual learner would, they would like pictures, diagrams, illustrations to help them in their learning. Oral wants to listen, and they a lot of times like lectures or recordings, and the kinesthetic learner likes to use experience and activity or experimentation. And the read and the write are they like reading material and writing summations. So my strengths are actually in the read write area, and with kinesthetics strongly in the background. And Vicky, you will know this, that my probably, the, even though I have great stage presence when I'm singing, my oral doesn't oftentimes connect with the read-write part of me, because I need to have notes in front of me in order to be able to speak. So that's one of the things that I know about myself. So there's an important thing about this model, because it shows how teachers can attempt to cover all styles in their conversation, but it's a kind of a loosey-goosey model. So I, you know, don't take too much credence in it, but for this fun exercise, it's doable, right? Because I'm, as I say, I'm going to use the I'm going to use the characters coming up here. Okay, so this is kind of the synopsis of How to Train Your Dragon. And it's, the story takes place in Berk, a mythical Viking village. You can see that in the corner there. Hiccup is an undersized teen who wishes to become a dragon slayer like the other Vikings. And he injures something called a night fury. You can see it down in, on the screen there below. And he's unable to bring himself to kill it. So instead he helps, befriends, and trains the dragon, and quickly discovers that things are not exactly as they seem in the conflict between the Vikings and the dragons. Anyway, so through a series of events, Hiccup is left behind in Berk while his father and the Viking warriors go after the dragons. So hatching a bold plan, Hiccup asks his training classmates to help him save the Viking warriors and Toothless from the Red Death Dragon.
Today, you will learn to fight dragons.
Pain. Love it.
Let's get started!
You should come by sometime to work out. You look like you work out.
I guess it's just you and me, huh?
No, just you.
Huh? Focus, Hiccup!
Can I transfer to the class with the cool Vikings?
Whoa. Has anyone ever tried to train a dragon?
No one's ever lived to tell the tale.
It's okay. I'm not gonna hurt you.
Let's see if this works. We're gonna take this nice and slow. Come on, buddy. Come on, buddy. Whoa!
Yeah! Get down!
It's okay. You just scared him.
I scared him?
Everything we know about them
is wrong.
Let me show you.
Either we finish them, or they'll finish us.
Fire!
We don't have to fight them.
Whoa.
Go, baby!
No matter how this ends, it ends today.
What are you gonna do?
Something crazy.
I'm in.
Me too.
Sign me up.
I love this plan.
Go.
How to Train Your Dragon.
Okay, and so these are the characters that we just saw in that clip, and they're the main characters, some of the main characters. Gobber the Belch is the mentor, coach, trainer, and he trains the kids, that of which Hiccup the Horrendous, our hero, is part of that particular team. So he has some rather unorthodox approaches. Like he just has the kids go into the trainees go into the ring, and he tells them, what is the first thing that you should be doing? And the dragons are attacking the kids, and He said, this is, one of the kids says, no, this is not right. This is not right. This is really not the way you train somebody. And he said, well, just consider it on the job training. And so he has a really interesting perspective about, you know, letting the kids just figure out, you know, under stressful circumstances, how to cope with the situation. And so it's kind of funny in that way, but there are some people who do train that way. So, I mean, I can think of one in my background who did exactly that, although the circumstances weren't like, you're going to, you know, you're going to get burned by a dragon or anything. So, so I used the bark on him using AI and discovered that he's a kinesthetic learner. So he likes the hands-on approach and likes the real life examples, practical exercises, and direct involvement in the learning process. And Hiccup the Horrendous, now he's the hero, as I say. His training style is unique and innovative, but as a trainee, he is a really incompetent at, you know, finds out that he's incompetent at killing the a dragon, and he finds another approach to the method of training instead of killing. So he's Hiccup is a kinesthetic learner because he does direct interaction with Toothless, the dragon, and he also likes, he is probably a visual learner because he goes to drawings. He's kind of an engineer, so he understands and knows how to communicate information or ideas about dragons. And then there's Stoic the Vast. He really is not a trainer in a sense, but what he is characterized by the traditional and authoritative trainer or authoritative training style. So Vicky, you may not like this guy. That's an inside joke. We had a little discussion about authority before the recording. So anyway, he's auditory, and I like that they say he values the traditions and storytelling, which are integral parts of Viking culture. In the book, he's not even able to read very well, so he's kind of a big klutz. And he kind of disowns Hiccup because Hiccup is not a typical, he's not the son of a chief. He's not a warrior. So anyway, then Toothless, the Night Fury, and he's a trainee of a different sort because as a dragon, he learns through direct experience, physical activity, and practice. And he does like the hands-on engagement because I think this dragon was actually, I think he was fashioned after a cat. That's my understanding. And when you see him, you know, kind of, you get the face that it's a little black cat with nice big green eyes. So he's obviously a kinesthetic learner because he's nonverbal, and he relies on nonverbal cues, you know, body language, which are really important to the kinesthetic learner. And then there are the trainees and the learners, I call them, because they are in training. Most of them are, they're pretty good at training with swords and shields and things like that. So all of the Roughnut, Toughnut, Astrid, and Snotlout are very kinesthetic and auditory. And Fishlegs, who is kind of, he loves to spout out all of these things about about statistics, as you just think of him as like somebody who knows everything about the Brooklyn Dodgers from zero, you know, year one to now. He's kind of, he knows everything about dragons. He can just spout that off. So his strong suits are reading, writing, and the visual aspect of learning. So Hiccup's intelligence, hands-on skills, and comparison allow him to change from a learner to trainee, into a dragon trainer and hero. So here's another clip. And so I would like to play this, Vicky. So maybe you could stop recording for a moment.
You guys go on ahead. I'll catch up with you.
Saw a summary of Hiccup's learning and training journey. It seemed a little glitchy, so I'll provide these links in the chat window before we adjourn. But the idea is Toothless is a great problem solver, and that's one of the things that we really want to be as trainers. So for example, Toothless lost a back tail fin and he can't fly. So the resolution is that Hiccup builds a prosthetic tailpiece for Toothless and is able to ride the dragon after the next problem. Because he can't get on to the dragon, he builds a harness and stirrups for Toothless so he can navigate using those particular pieces of equipment. And then Hiccup does not want to kill Toothless or any dragon. He finds that he can't bring himself to killing a dragon. He's too compassionate, and he realizes that they're not a threat. So he finds a different solution, because when he trains Toothless, Hiccup discovers how to train the dragons and can use them, things in the arena. So for instance, he sees what Toothless was in the grass, and it was sort of like catnip, I guess. And then he uses that on a specific dragon in the arena, and the dragon is just completely complacent, and he does that also with the dragon that uses he's a playful thing, but he's really ferocious when he jumps on you. And so he finds another way by doing the mirror on the ground, and gets them back into the cage, gets the dragon back into the cage. And there are a couple of other things that were in that clip, but I don't expect you to remember them, and I'm not going to go through any more than that. But the important thing is that we ha often have to ad lib. We have to do certain things that we in our training, so that that may be unorthodox, but helps the learner to learn. And so, getting pretty close to being finished here. So there's some skills of the exceptional trainer, and I've kind of developed this list from the reading and also from what I learned from the actual movie and comparing it. So definitely know your subject matter thoroughly before you start to train. It's really important that you have some connection with it. Hiccup starts with accessing the dragon book, reference book. He's not a very good fighter, so he figures out ways that to find the dragon's weaknesses so that he can find this other way of training them. And he doesn't know that at the time that he's going through this process, that he is learning how he's got ways of training these dragons. He tries to research toothless, but there's not re much research on his particular kind. So he has to learn kinesthetically how his trainee functions, and he has to really know the subject really well. Then it's really good to have strong communication skills, because effective communication is really the cornerstone. It's about facilitating and understanding your learners. And in this case, these learners are together all the time. Sometimes you're not with your learners all the time when you're a trainer. You maybe be going from one place to another, but if you are working with a baseball team or something like that, and you're the trainer, you have contact with that person a lot. So develop the communication skills and apply them back and forth to those places. Like if you teach Bible, Sunday school or something like that, you can use your skills in the Bible classroom itself, because you have that kind of understanding of training and the learner itself. And of course, always organizational skills are helpful for both the trainer and the person involved, the learner or whoever you're training or talking to or learning with. So it's a really important critical skill. Another important critical skill for trainers is the ability to problem solve. And so a lot of times, as Hiccup's case, he was able to solve some problems in kind of thinking out of the box. So he organizes by sketching plans. Hiccup organizes by sketching plans for parts, and then he also has a cheat sheet to show him how to drive the dragon or ride the dragon. So he's got all of these really good problem-solving inventions. But we can do that too. We can figure out different ways to, if there's some type of gap in our training, then we just go back and find out where that is and then try to make it better, right? And teach all to all styles of learners, because as I'm sure we all know, people learn in different ways. That's the reason I brought up this the VARC. But so you use all of those possibilities that you can to fill the void if for somebody who may not be as strong in, let's say, oral, may, you know, back it up with some type of read, write, you know, some material like a training manual or sorts. So Hiccup really trains Toothless using all senses, and he's able to fly again because of because of accessibility with that with the prosthetic on his tail. And so Hiccup is really good at training a lot, you know, people, actually at the dragons. And he even Fish Legs, if you recall, he was the one with a little bit different learning ability, and he even brings in Fish Legs and helps him be strong in what he can do well in the movie. So be adaptable. Again, you know, figure out plan B. If your training is not working so well, then you can use Hiccup's plan B was to use dragons to transport his classmates to obliterate the dragon, the red dragon. So another thing, be curious, always be curious, because in contrast to high performers who really think they their way is the only way to learn, maybe it is good to see things from a different viewpoint. And one of the things that's really important is when you're curious, you also have your kind of understanding and your have an empathetic viewpoint for other people. So for Hiccup, obviously, he's curious, and it helps him discover that Toothless is not a threat to the Vikings. And by creating a prosthesis for the dragon and training through compassion, Hiccup and Toothless respect each other through trust. And so I think that's also important, that you have kind of a trust with your trainer and your learner. So be both trainer and learner. I think that this is really important, because sometimes we need to step into the shoes of the learner. And, you know, like, for example, you might want to learn something from a photographer. And you don't know a whole lot, but you have to be kind of humble. And, you know, people just don't start at the top if they're just beginning to learn. So have the humility to be a learner as well, because learning and training go hand in hand. In conclusion, in learning, you will teach, and in teaching, you will learn. This is a Phil Collins verse. And I think that this is really mindful to keep when you're training and when you need to take your learner's viewpoint into mind. So this concludes the practical lessons in training and learning. And I just want to say that I think that everyone is a learner and everyone is a teacher, and especially in informal ways, sometimes we don't look at the fact that we can actually be a trainer, or we can actually be a learner if we don't know that much about the subject. So my suggestion is use your skills as a technical communicator and an instructional designer to become better at both training and learning. So that's That's all, folks. And we have a few minutes here. I wanted to know if you had any questions or comments, or if you would like to share any of your formal training experiences, or I have some questions up there if you are interested in talking a bit about anything. So have any of you had an experience where, you know, you felt like you were training kind of off the cuff, so to say, in a situation where you, you know, might not be in a formal training area or in the capacity of a formal situation? No.
All right, I'll jump in. We'll have the explanation. Vicky's having trouble with authority. I am getting ready to participate in onboarding for new employees. And my training style, I do best as a tutor, where I can work with a small number of what we call them trainees, I guess, a small number of new employees. The training that I have been assigned is very much a PowerPoint based training, and I'm not a fan of the PowerPoint. I really like that sort of give and take, that sort of a tutor, mentor, mentee kind of a thing. Works out for. So what I have designed instead of PowerPoint is I'm going to be teaching them how to edit to our style guide. And so I have a document that I have on purpose made terrible. It's got passive voice, all of the fonts, none of the fonts are bold. There's no bulleted lists. We've used a gerund. It's a strange title. I've really tried to give them a lot of meat. And so I want, it's going to be just two in the class. And I want to be able to teach to their level. And I won't know what their level is until I get there, right? Mm-hmm. And I feel like that is absolutely the best way, just like Hiccup, right? He learned from the dragon what the dragon needed, how the dragon responded, what was the problem with the dragon, with the prosthetic. You know, you kind of go as you go. It's certainly harder for me to prove to the people who are overall running the training umbrella that this is my style, because they really want to make sure that I cover the right stuff. So I'm having to balance that out, and you can wish me luck. Our new employees arrive on the 17th, and I am really excited because I love the sort of tutor training style. I am very much the vacation Bible school music teacher. That is my thing, right? I get everybody in the, and we have sort of a thing, and then we let it go, and those that want to sing will sing, and those that want to dance will dance, and those that just want to sit will sit, as long as I feel like I have everyone engaged and learning something, I feel like it's a win. So take it away, Maralee. Give me some advice and tell me to start respecting authority.
Well, it sounds like you have a great plan. And hopefully, like Hiccup, you can be a hero and show them that your way is really a good way. I think, because you don't necessarily have to, you just have to prove that your way really is strong and does the job. And, you know, with that groundwork, I think you just need to kind of step up and say, this is what the way I'd like to do it. And then if you get pushback, well, then maybe you will have to go that way. So I don't know.
For example, I really want to do an assessment before and after.
Good idea.
And that's one of the things that we learn in instructional design, ADDIE, analyze, design, develop, mm-hmm. implement, evaluate. Evaluate is the thing that we often forget. And I do want to do a before and after assessment. I was just going to do it on the students can rate 1 to 10 their confidence in a couple of areas. It'll be a simple assessment. It won't take very long. I won't have to give them a quiz or anything like that. There won't be any stress related to the assessment, but I really feel like that's important.
So are you going to do like a before and after assessment? Like, so right now, how confident do you feel at the beginning of this training?
Right. Yeah. How confident are you with your ability to use Microsoft Word? How confident are you with your ability to read our style guide and understand what it says? How confident are you to understand some of the big concepts like search engine optimization? Because some of what we do in our style guide is related to how employees search for the information they need. Mm-hmm. You know, those kinds of things. So wish me luck.
Well, good luck.
Thank you.